Hey guys, welcome back to Seed Story Cup. We are now starting the second group stage. We will be casting Group B, which is going to have Jackie Chan, Torik, Ecop,
and Stansifka.
So interesting matches ahead, guys, and hope you guys enjoy this first match we have between Torik, your teammate, and Ecop. So what do we see in the initial group stage between these guys? I think they had similar lineups, right?
Yeah, I think they have like the exact same lineup.
Yeah, both bringing Pirate Warrior, Rogue, Face Shaman, and Priest as their final deck. And in this opening match here, we have Ecop opening with Priest versus Torik's Face Shaman.
Yeah, and as we said before, the opening was really important in that one.
Yeah.
And I think Ecop got the advantage here.
Picking
Priest against Shaman.
Huge. And I believe both players banned their Pirate Warriors, so no Pirate Warrior will be played in this series.
But anyway, it's Hearthstone, so Shaman can always take it. And
yeah, definitely see. One of those matchups where you probably want to have Sir Finley into something like Life Tap.
Oh, he got patches and stuff.
Yeah, patches,
which
unfortunate.
Is, like, always bad.
Super unfortunate.
But in the other hand, Ecop has no dragon in hand, so he couldn't place Whelp.
Yeah, no Whelp activation here. Do you ever just play the dragon here?
Ha!
Or do you go with the Shadow of Pain?
This
Ooh,
be.
That's nice.
Yeah. That was needed.
I like the Twilight Whelp here over the Nether Sprite Historian just to be able to contest.
Because Nether Sprite would be just traded by the Buccaneer.
Yeah.
That's not what you want.
And on Torik's side, he does have the weapon, so he does have the way to deal with this. And he can even decide to coin out the patches and just, you know, face tank the Whelp. Trade the patches in.
I like the idea on this turn, but if you do that, you cannot coin the Feral Spirit.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
It's tough. Definitely tough. At the same time, you got
to
think, you know,
you have to think what's going to come on turn.
Turn three.
And probably Torik saw that Ecop was running Blackwing Technicians. So he's going for display, which is going to pay off.
It's definitely a card that not a lot of Dragon Priests are running this card, but it's a 3/5 on turn 3. Definitely a very powerful minion to play on turn 3.
Yeah, I agree.
And Ecop going to be rewarded here by having this included in his deck. He's gonna be able to contest both the small time Buccaneer plus waste the last charge on the weapon that Torik has here.
Yeah, that's a good draw, but not for now.
Yeah, that'll certainly be a nice late game resource for Torik. And he decides to use the Lightning Bolt instead. Smart play there. Preserve the small-time Buccaneer.
Yeah, essentially you have a second weapon. I think it's really valuable to preserve it. But yeah, Ecop's curve is so strong.
Yeah, Ecop's curving out with the best possible minion on each mana slot.
Oh, thinking about Shadow Pain?
Thinking about the Pain here, wow. I mean, what other targets does he have with that Pain? He does have things like Totem Golem later on that are a little bit stronger.
Yep.
Ooh, snap picking the bookworm there.
Yeah, I didn't even see that.
I didn't even see what other options he had.
So yeah, Fire Spirits.
The overload's a little unfortunate here. He can't go with the Tunnel Trog into the Feral Spirits.
Yeah. But the good point is he's probably not gonna be overloaded on turn 6, so he can play his Aya on curb. Draconid Imperative, like the Maybe you want to go for Blackwing Corruption?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't mind Draconid Operative on this turn.
Yeah, I don't mind it either. I guess in Ecop's mind, he's got, you know, Blackwing Corruptor into Bookworm just to be able to maintain this board.
Okay,
he's probably not running Dragonfire Potion, right? So definitely don't want to fall too far behind on the board against a Shaman.
So you cannot roll the Totem here. Maybe use is Maelstrom Portal that good? Okay, he's probably just gonna face and
So he doesn't want to go with the 25% spell power totem roll. Decides it's just safer to go with the Maelstrom here. But unfortunate for him, the Bookworm is in hand to be able to get through the taunt and then get a clean trade onto the Tunnel Trog with his 5/3. So in the end, it worked out. It worked out that he went with the Blackwing Corruptor last turn.
Because of the
over the Draconoid, And yeah,
is Aya gonna be enough to come back on the
ball? I don't know. I mean,
I don't think so.
It's a 2-2, yeah. So it's not super powerful quite yet. And Torque's pretty much all in on this hand. So there's no burn in hand. He's utilized all his weapons. So if this board can get dealt with by Ekop, definitely the stabilization has occurred.
Unless Torque is running like a Doomhammer.
Yeah, Doomhammer would be huge. Is that an inclusion that he has in the deck,
I don't think he has.
Okay. So he's going to be looking for cards like Sir Finley, try to get Life Tap, try to have additional resources coming in for him.
Yeah, it's time for Ekop to play a taunt, because it's the only way you lose, right?
Yeah.
If you control Shen.
Yeah, he's already done 18. Definitely the kind of the scary point where, double Lava Burst is something that you should consider as well. So he's thinking about, he's definitely concerned. He's not sure if he should play it super safe or he should go Draconaut Operative. If he decides to play it safe, go for the cycle and the taunt, which I like. I like this play.
Yeah. Big Black Encryptor, which is a good card if you want to. Second Flame Tongue was a terrible draw.
Yeah, very bad draw. Really can't even be utilized at all this turn. And, he decides to take out the cycle on Ekop's side. I like the play. I like missing the 3 damage to just stop the cycle. But unfortunate for him, there's just, like you mentioned, the Blackwing Corruptor from last turn. Now Holy Nova's been top decked. He could even go with the Bookworm this turn. It's does not look too good for Torque this turn.
Yeah, as expected. Priest is probably gonna win this game.
Yeah.
So Dark is gonna counter that with his Rogue. But then the Shaman is. I mean, that's a terrible.
Yeah, so winning this first game is huge for Ekop because it allows him to, I think, have the advantage. So, assuming things go to plan, he's gonna have the advantage going into game.
Yeah, just because
they
have the exact same lineup.
Exactly. And look at Torque here. So he decides that he top decks the Lava Burst, he has the Spell Power Totem on board. Decides to just go face with it. Is there any sequence of draws that he could have here, though, to finish out 9 damage? We have to assume that the board is going to be dealt with here by Ekop.
Yeah, I'm not sure because, he's probably going to die in, 2 turns.
Yeah, he himself is at 18 already, and he's going to take another 8 here.
As I said, I think the only out is, a Doomhammer into Rockbiter, and Ekop is even playing around that by hitting himself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, even that wouldn't even be enough at this point.
Yep.
So, Feral Spirit's not the draw he wants, and Tor concedes there, losing game one to Ekop's Dragon Priest. And we got to assume, like you said, he's probably thinking Rogue is the go-to class here.
Yeah, because you don't really want to now rely on Mirror Priest.
Yeah, you definitely don't want to rely on the Mirror match. One of those matchups where whoever draws better initially definitely is very far ahead. So. We got to assume that Torque's going to go with the Rogue here to counter this Dragon Priest of Ekop, and hoping to get the win here. He needs this win to kind of even things out, and as we see here in the game, we have Torque queuing that Rogue and double questing Backstab Opener. Probably not what he wants.
Yeah, maybe one.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind keeping one there.
Yeah, I think Shadow Strike is really good against Priest.
Yeah, it's one of those things where a lot of rogues are shifting away from Shadow Strike, going to double sap. A couple guys like the one sap, one Shadow Strike for the Dragon Priest, maybe the Reno matchup the Shadow Strike's better in as well.
I mean, if you don't ban Shaman and you expect a lot of Priest, then Shadow Strike is definitely a good card.
Yeah, for sure.
Even good Vanguard. So, yeah, I think you just pass. There's no point.
Yeah, I like the pass there. Ekop again with the early game plays. He's got the Northshire into the Nether Spider Storm. What do you pick here? Let's see.
I don't know. Probably Volcanic Drake. There's some turn where you trade one or two minions and you can play it for
four mana.
So that's probably the best option.
Yeah, Yeah, I think at this point he's probably considering maybe he wants to have like a, you know, a Twilight Whelp just to kind of, you know, pressure the Rogue as much as possible early.
Yeah,
that's one of the ways
like
to win this matchup.
Oh.
Ooh, going with the Midnight Drake.
Yeah, I will never show that with that one, but let's see what he's going
to
do with that.
Maybe his plan is to curve out, you know, Bronzebeard next turn, followed by maybe, you know, Twilight Guardian into Midnight Drake. And Torkoal, yeah, just going with the standard play of stopping the cycle chain in the Northshire Cleric there.
Brand is coming down. I guess you have to kill it.
Yeah, must kill card.
Yeah.
For Torque here. And his hand looks pretty good. He's got, you know, he's got the Drake, he's got the Shadow Strike, he has a lot of low costing spells. We don't see a Shadow or Death on Ecop's side, so if at any point in these next couple turns Torque decides to go off with the Edwin.
Yeah. Ecop's not gonna be able to transfer.
Yeah, won't be able to deal with it. And it's tough because you know that the Twilight Guardian's coming down next turn. So, you know, using the Shadow Strike here, you know, it can't feel too good if Torque decides to go with it.
Oh, he's probably going to go for Van Cleef then.
He's going. It looks like he's going for the Van Cleef now. Just making a 4-4. Okay. I mean, I guess he's not too punished by, you know, something like Twilight Guardian coming down next turn because he has that Shadow Strike and then he can cleanly trade into the Bronze.
Yeah, I like that. I like that a lot.
That was very good, you know, good decision making there by Torque.
Yeah,
very
really good for you.
Being patient with his Shadow Strike, yeah.
Plus the fact that he has a good trade with Van Cleef into Brand.
Yeah. And this is where the tempo swings in the favor of the Rogue, and he's now going to have a 4-2 on board, which is always hard to deal with four attack minions for a Priest. And he's going to have those Drakes coming up back-to-back, so definitely the tempo has shifted in Torque's favor at this point.
Unless Ecop top decks have like a Blackwing Corruptor.
Yeah, that's going to be huge for Ecop at this point. It's going to be the one way that he has, you know, not only does he have the Blackwing Corruptor on the board that can test with the Drake, but he gets rid of the Edwin Van Cleef as well. But that is not it, so.
So, yeah, what do you see? Probably, definitely not Midnight Drake, because you just
dies to the Edwin, yeah. At the same time, yeah, the Blackwing, I mean, I like the Blackwing tech. It's one of the cards where it survives, you know, I mean. The Rogue does have the weapon equipped, so he's going to be able to trade both in and then develop the Drake into an empty board.
Oh, wow,
huge
great
card.
Follow-up.
Yeah.
Pillager into probably Eviscerate.
Yeah, he's got great follow-ups on Torque's side. He's down to 17, so he has, you know, he's had a pressuring start from the Priest, but he's been able to out-tempo him at this point, which is usually what happens in this matchup, and once cards like Gadget come into his hand, he's going to be able to start a cycle train once he gets the coin from the pillager.
Yeah, usually that's how the matchup works. Like, the priest is able to put some pressure on early game, but he can never finish, like, the 10 last HP. So.
Yeah, exactly. And Ecop just going with his only play there, which is to drop something that can test with the Drake. But like you mentioned earlier, the pillager into Eviscerate is a nice clean answer for this Midnight Drake.
Keeping your Drake alive, which is like a huge threat for Priest.
And you don't really worry about, you know, cards like Dragonfire Potion, because, you know, most Priests are cutting them out. They're just too slow for the meta that we're in. So these four health minions are just super, super hard to deal with when the Priest has no board on their side.
And even if he was running that, Azure Drake doesn't die by...
Like you said, the Azdrake just survives the Dragonfire Potion, you know, itself. Ooh, huge Nether Spite Historian there for Ecop. But not a great answer out of the operative.
Oh, is that all bad? Maybe patches. So if you pick up a Blackwing Corruptor, then you can finish the trade with the patches.
Yeah, I mean, you don't even have Holy Nova in hand, so.
It's not, like, insane, but it's probably the best choice out of those three.
Agreed. And Ecop sees the line, he goes with the patches himself. But Torque here with the Drake.
Oh, we can see what, like, preparation. Oh, no.
Yeah, he just decides to play it slow and just, take out the Draconoid. And, yeah, look at this board. Wow.
Yeah, that's so...
I mean, does he have lethal next turn? Nah, no lethal in hand yet for Torque next turn.
And he used both Eviscerate, so there's a few chances that he tapped next lethal.
And Ecop with, you know, no dragons in hand, just dropping the Northshire, cycling a little bit here. just kind of going with the flood the board, cross my fingers plan. Yeah. But we see the Fan of Knives with
look at this.
Three potential spell power.
It's going to be four.
Yeah, it's going to be a four damage. That's going to be a flame strike for three mana. Not too shabby. Do you ever prep it here?
I don't know. Yeah, probably because you have two, and if you top deck something, you can play.
Yeah, the hand's kind of dead with those preps, yep. But he decides to just kind of play it slow. I don't mind it. Yeah, E-Cop kind of smirking there, not happy with the flame strike for three mana.
So, you definitely have to play Cold Blood on this turn, probably on the Pillager.
Yeah, it's already a Shadow or Death target, so definitely want to keep those Drakes healthy and out of... You know, there's really no way for the Priest to deal with them, so...
Trade with that one.
Definitely
like.
Cold Blood here to set up the...
Oh.
Ooh, he puts it on the Drake, okay.
Okay, why not?
I mean, I really don't think there's any combination of cards that...
That
deals with this
storm,
board, yeah. Light Bomb is no longer a thing, so...
And probably it was... I mean... Yeah, if maybe Ikab was running, like, the Draconic Potion, then it was a best choice.
Yeah, then it was a bit better. Okay. And,
yeah,
Ikab... Yeah. Does a little patches trade there, but it's not enough to stop the incoming lethal, so... Torque, as we expected, going with Rogue,
exactly.
Winning the favorable matchup now, but it's a battle, and that first game was super important. You know,
yeah.
Winning that first game was huge, so I think E-Cop's still ahead based on how things have gone. You know, I think Torque's going to have to win Rogue versus Aggro Shaman now.
Yeah.
And so it's going to be, you know, whoever breaks the chain and wins an unfavorable matchup is going to be ahead at this point. So let's see if the Rogue can beat this Aggro Shaman by E-Cop here, which we're assuming is going to queue, and... Yep, as expected, there is E-Cop with the Aggro Shaman. It's one of those matchups where it's definitely gotten better now that a lot of Shamans are cutting cards like Doomhammer from their deck. I think the Rogue is able to withstand the Shaman a bit better.
Yeah,
but,
Doomhammer was definitely a troubling card for Rogues.
Very, very troubling card for Rogues. And E-Cop with a pretty good opening there.
Yep.
And, but on the other side, we have, you know, pretty good opening by Torque as well.
Yeah. And he got the counterfeit coin, which allows him to play, like, some particular plays, like, yeah.
Yeah, and I definitely don't like coining out the Totem Golem here, so normally you want to coin that out, but in this situation, it just dies so easily to the small time.
He still
does it, okay.
I
mean, it helps you gain tempo back, so, like, you know that this is kind of telling the Rogue to just hero power here, and he's not really developing anything else.
Yeah, that's a problem, but... Yeah, what did you want to do else?
Yeah, if you go Sir Finley, it's like...
You give, like, a free trade.
You give a free trade.
You don't have Portal in.
Yeah, then you have to kind of coin out the Argent Horse Rider to deal with it. It's definitely gets ugly, so this is kind of the only play, and it's frustrating for the Shaman because, you know, usually a turn 2, 3, 4, a turn 1, 3, 4 is not going to get dealt with, but ever since this new expansion, the small-time Buccaneer has been able to be a pretty strong card on turn one, especially for the Rogue class that always has a guaranteed weapon on turn two.
Oh, okay.
Coining out the Shadow Strike. Interesting. So he kind of sees that his hand's kind of clunky with, you know, two counterfeit coins. He decides to preserve his board and keep the small time healthy.
Like, if you expect, like, a Trogon on this turn.
Yeah, it's huge. That's a good read.
It was a good read.
Yeah.
Okay, it's a Sarfin lab, but basically it's, like, the same body, so...
Exactly. So good read there by Torek, you know, coining that Shadow Strike out. And E-Cop, you know, realizing that it's more important to try to get back on this board. It goes with the Druid Hero Power over something like Life Tap, which is generally a consideration against decks like Rogue.
Yeah, looks like he's doing well for Torek at the moment.
Yeah, no Maelstrom in hand, but he does have the Argent Horse Rider, which is... a card that not all Aggro Shamans are now running. You know, a lot of them cut it out just to fit in.
What do you
full
prefer? Like, you could also play like the Pirate and Aeropower.
Yeah, you
so
do
you
get your patches to get, you know, out of your deck
you
as
the
well.
Patches of, out of your deck.
I think the South Sea Captain is actually a better option. You clear the board. You come ahead on board as well. But on Torque side, we do see the turn 4 Tomb Pillager coming down. And E-Cop, you know, not sure what to do here. I mean, it's one of those things where he might not even realize Patches is still in his deck. So once you're, like, past turn one or two, sometimes your mind kind of plays tricks on you and you kind of forget that Patches is still something that's going to get pulled.
Usually, like,
you expect it to come out on turn one, so when it doesn't, it's like you kind of forget about it. And maybe that's something that Ecop didn't realize, that if you played Southsea there, you would have pulled the patches. But, you definitely do not want to be this far behind against a Rogue on turn four. Tomb Pillager coming down for Torque.
Oh, but this is good.
Yeah, this is pretty huge. And there's no clean answer on Torque's side. He's already used one backstab.
Yep.
Let's see what he draws here on his subsequent turn. He does have two coins in hand. We know that a lot of these aggressive shamans aren't playing cards like Hex. So definitely making this questing as big as possible, as soon as possible, is always a consideration for him.
Oh, he's going far. Okay.
I like this.
Yeah, I like this. You want to throw the Trog and... Yeah, but...
The only problem is Jade Lightning, so...
Yeah,
there's no Jade Lightning right now. You know he has 4 mana next turn. Lucky enough for him. Yeah. Ooh, that's an answer,
though.
Yeah,
no Jade Lightning, but no, your Subsea Deckhand can have charge.
Yeah.
So you can get rid of this.
And most certainly we're going to see the trade by Ecop here. You definitely don't want this question to get out of control.
You're gonna get your brushes.
And using that coin early, now the gadget draw is not as good as it would have been.
Yeah, Ecop is kinda low in HP and he doesn't have a strong board. He's overloaded, so he won't be able to play Ion turn 6, which is important.
And what does Torque do next turn? So he does have the gadget with the coin and potentially a sap. It doesn't feel good to sap anything on the board. He does want to sap things like Aya.
Yep.
So we'll see what Torque does. But yeah, like you said, he's got an ECOP down to 17 already. So we're approaching that range where things like Leroy Coldblood could close the game out shortly.
I guess you Jade Lightning face. I mean, you would like to keep it for like a Drake or even a gadget in action, yeah, but...
Yeah, I like the Jade Lightning here just because you have that Aya follow-up, so... Yep. You want to start making those big Jade Golems.
And you trade like with your weapon and with the 1-1. You probably trade with the 1-1, right?
Yeah, I don't think I value the 1-1 too much.
Yeah, because of the dagger. And
yeah, it just dies the dagger anyway. I guess Ecop's consideration here is, things like Drake could be coming down, things like the second Pillager, so he kind of wants to save the Jade Lightning for those things, but he decides that, the Aya next turn is too important to make sure that it gets value, so he decides...
Oh, he's going to phase with the...
Okay, so he's going to trade the weapon in.
I don't know about that, because no, you cannot kill the gadget and auctioneer.
Yeah, you kind of miss more damage doing it this way, and you also, like you said, don't have a clean way to deal with the gadget.
Oh, he's not playing it?
Ooh, he's going to get greedy
here. With the coin in hand and
preparation? Yeah, with the prep.
Oh, I would have loved to see it now.
I think he might get rewarded because he has sap for the Aya next turn, but... Yeah,
okay, I see. So he's probably thinking, I don't want to use my sub, so...
Maybe he thinks, that Jade Lightning kind of gives away. Maybe Ecop's going for a big Aya next turn. Thank you.
Okay, I see.
So he's going to get rewarded here, and I wonder if you're Ecop here, do you ever play the Flame Tongue? I think it's just a snap play Aya here.
Depends on what you draw, but...
Yeah. Ooh.
Oh.
It's tempting for sure.
It is. And yeah, he's doing that.
Yeah.
Even playing the Flame Tongue.
And Ecop knows, he's down to 16. He knows the Rogue Burst in one turn is it's very high potential. There's no, there's no real damage on Torque's side, but he does have a huge gadget coming down if he wants to this turn. And yeah, he sees
play it now.
Gotta play it now.
With like two kinds of preparation. Oh.
Oh, wow.
Even backstab now.
Yeah. I believe there's one fan left in the deck. Ooh, Eviscerate's huge as well. This could be a full clear here.
Yep. Okay, see if I can stop that.
And this is huge. So, this is going to be a questing that's, both Jade Lightnings are gone, so it's going to have at least 4 health here.
Just sap. Oh, I will have left. Maybe sap.
Do you think sap's better than the Eviscerate? Save the damage, try
to
close. Yeah, he sees it too.
You're close to lethal.
Super close,
so.
Yeah. You're kind of putting Ecop on drawing Feral Spirits next turn.
Oh, you can even
play
both. He's playing that, which I like because...
I like it. Just make this thing out of Lava Burst range. How does it die? There's no, we know there's no hexes in Ecop's side.
And he's going to face with the Eviscerate.
Yep, I like it.
So, Ecop has either to kill Torg or to kill this questing, and I don't think...
Yeah, 14 damage with no Doom Hammers doesn't look possible.
Ooh. Oh, Feral Spirit. Definitely a good pickup.
Yeah, but we see the Drake into Spell Power. Does that do it with the weapon established? Yeah. The Drake into Fan is going to be enough for Torque next turn.
So, Torque is basically going to win a bad matchup.
Yeah, he kind of broke the chain where...
So,
taking
the lead here in this best of five.
Yeah, and Southsea Captain. Or Southsea Deckhand, interesting tech that I've seen a couple rogues in this tournament having in there. I guess he's cutting cards like Swash Burglar out of his
probably.
Deck. Okay. And like you said, Torque kind of breaking the chain, winning an unfavorable matchup, and pulling ahead now. So he lost the first game, which was huge, but he's won these last two games, doing rogue things, and Ecop now has to...
Ecop is not in bad position.
Yeah.
I mean, he was in the better position before that game, but now... He basically has the mirror matchup, and if he wins that, he's in a good position.
He's got the Aggro Shaman. Well, he's got the Aggro Shaman. Oh, no.
No, he's got the Priest.
Oh, he's got the Priest, yeah. So he's actually, it's not even that far ahead,
it's
to
like
be honest.
It's like 50-50 from that point.
He's got a 50-50 into like a favorable, so it's definitely still behind for Ecop, but he's not too far behind. So that goes to show, winning that first game was just huge for Ecop. And we see the mirror match opening. So we see... a turn one by Ecop, the Swash Burglar, is definitely something that Torque doesn't have on his side.
Oh.
Ooh, Beneath the Grounds.
That's be good.
You know, that's interesting. That's a card that Civitz is actually playing in his Miracle Rogue as a one.
Yeah, because it's good against Reno.
Yeah, it's good against Reno, definitely.
I think he's going to play it on the tree.
Yeah. Especially with Torque probably just going to hear Power Pass here. I mean, both players have great hands. You know, they both have Pillagers coming down. They both have those preps. They both have the gadget.
And a 4-4 body is, like, really annoying for Rogue. So it's going to matter a lot. Like, at what point Torque draws the Nerubian.
It's going to be huge, And I wonder what Torque does here. So he's probably going to get the initiative of the Pillager.
Yeah.
I got to assume he's going to coin it out here. Yeah, that's the first snap play that he does.
But Ecop has preparation, so if he gets like a sap or eviscerate, he can reverse the tempo.
And if not, he's just going to have to play the Pillager to the Pillager. And do you ever sap it if you're here, if you're Torque?
Yeah, of course.
And then get your...
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't want the Pillager to die because it gives a coin to your opponent. So, I would have loved to see the sap.
Yeah, I think the sap and develop maybe the weapon so that next turn you have Southsea Captain with patches. You can even take out the Pillager by trading everything in, just keeping your Pillager alive.
You could even sap and maybe go for like one Cold Blood, maybe?
And then develop a pirate as well. Yeah, you could sap Cold Blood. Maybe he's even considering cold-blooding the patches into the Pillager, but I really do like the sap and, like you said, preventing the coin.
Okay, he's going for Shadow Strike.
Okay.
Just I don't know.
Yeah.
Because, like, if you sap it here, then you know he has, like, 5 mana next turn, and he probably wants to eviscerate the Pillager if you have, like, a cold-blood on it, and so he cannot replay his Pillager, so I don't know.
And what do you do if you're Ecop here? Do you go with the second Pillager? Do you ever coin the gadget with the double prep in hand? I think it's safer to just play the Pillager.
Yeah, you play the Pillager, so you have like a huge gadget on turn.
Unfortunately for him, looking at Torque's hand here, so
he's
he has sap, double cold blood. Oh man, so a lot of damage has been accumulated on Torque's side here. And I don't know, I'm kind of scared for Ecop, but he decides
to... Okay, so he's going for the directive play.
Yeah, I like this. I don't mind this. He's definitely very far behind at this point.
Yeah, he has like true preparation, so...
Yeah.
Cannot be bad.
Has to use it for tempo here to try to come back in this game.
And if he gets sap, backstab.
Ooh, bad order there.
Not the best time to get it.
Yeah.
And just pass. Oh,
it's pretty good.
In Nerubian. Yeah, I might change something. Ha. What do you do here?
Yeah, so gadget's not really a consideration, and that Nerubian's huge. I mean, at this point, Torque's got to feel that he's probably lost control of this board, and he's looking at Ecop's hand, he's going to keep...
His hand was kind of dead, so that's why I liked the Cold Blood on last turn a lot.
Mm-hmm. It would have been huge last turn,
Yeah.
And there would have been no answer to it either, so it would have connected again this turn.
There's still no answer.
Yeah, there is still no answer. That's very true. And yeah, Ecop looking kind of
Oh, he got the answer.
Huge draw.
So what do you play here?
Yeah, do you ever go gadget prep Zap?
Yeah, I'll probably gadget again. I mean, you saw a Zap, you saw an Eviscerate.
You also see that Torx had three cards in hand right now, so having that huge, huge card advantage is definitely a welcoming thing in this matchup.
Yep.
And yeah, Ecop decides it's the best play, so he goes with the prep, see what he gets here.
An Eviscerate, but yeah, you probably prefer to Zap it.
Yeah.
Okay, it's probably gonna be enough for this turn. Yeah.
Yeah, and he's got the subsequent answers now with the Eviscerate, and he's got Backstab with the spell power. So, Ecop kind of clawing his way back into this game and taking advantage of those two preps to kind of swing the tempo back in his favor.
Yeah, Darkstorm is gonna be so weak. Like, he's probably just gonna play Pillager and Dagger.
Yeah, I mean that's all he can really do. He can't even answer the gadget, so. Definitely an unanswered gadget on Ecop's side is going to allow him to kind of just cycle through the rest of his deck. And what Torx kind of doing now is, yeah, like he said, he's lost board a couple turns ago, and he's kind of realized that he's probably never going to get board back. So he's kind of have to has to piece together lethal over a couple turns, and I don't see the damage there right now. Even with Leroy off the top, he still only has 11 damage.
Yeah, that's a problem. Yeah, you will need like two turns and top decking like Leroy into Eviscerate, but do you even have two turns here?
Yeah, do you even have those two turns? We already see a consideration here is to start making that questing. I mean, now that you drew the conceal.
I don't know. Probably. You only have to think about, okay, I have to kill him in two turns. What's the best play to do that?
I think making a big cut questing is probably the route that he wants to take for that.
Yeah. Backstab, and then you're probably gonna. I don't know.
Do you ever Visface here? Nah, I think it's too low.
Can't.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, like it's like the only chance to lose.
Yeah, it's
this is a
nice.
Big. Yeah. So with that draw, you're like, almost 100% sure that you're gonna have lethal next turn.
Yeah, Ecop has pretty much set it up so he's gonna have lethal next turn. He's kind of putting torque on having. Something like Leroy Coldblood prep of this turn, and we don't see quite that in hand right now. So, Ecop, very fortunate here with his gadget going unanswered and being able to set up lethal over two turns. And yeah, that is enough. And Torx has to just concede there. And Ecop tying it up 2-2 with his rogue mirror match.
Yeah, I think the key turn was like when Torx decided not to play the Coldblood, but he had like basically a dead end.
Yeah, and we saw Ecop had no answer to the cold-blooded pillager if Torx went through with it. So that could have went the other way there for Torx if he maybe made a couple different decisions. But now we have Torx with his priest deck, his dragon priest, to counter this rogue. And it's not that bad of a matchup. So I think people will kind of over-exaggerate how bad of a matchup it is for the priest. Yeah. I think it's something like 40% for the priest. So not the worst of matchups for the priest.
Yeah, basically there's no more Blade Flurry. So if you just take the board... Sometimes the rogue cannot come back.
That's the huge thing that the priest wants to do. They want to have turn one into turn two into turn three. So they want to put the pressure on the rogue early. Like you said, there's no AoE on the rogue side. So that is definitely one way that they control the border early on and put the pressure on the rogue.
So as the rogue, you probably want like the Buccaneer and then some backstab or stuff. So you make sure you don't lose the early board.
Yeah, definitely looking for those backstabs, looking for the early pirates. And we don't see any in hand right now for Ecop.
Yeah. It's probably gonna throw out everything.
Yeah, we see a full mulligan, and
okay, that's not a bad end.
Yeah,
with the Van Cleef in the end.
Yeah, with the coin, I guess maybe you go. Do you ever go for an early all in?
Like turn one Van Cleef? maybe it's you have like no follow up for the next three turns if you do that.
Yeah. You have really nothing, and you're using all your gas.
And even just cunning out a Van Cleef on turn 2, it's like a 4-4. A priest has no way to answer a 4-4. So.
Yeah, it's also still on the priest to kind of put the pressure on you. Right now, we don't really see the best of hands. That fairy dragon's pretty big, so now he has a guaranteed turn 2 play.
So yeah, use the coin.
Yeah, I like this.
Yeah.
Super, super smart. Contest with a lot of the turn 2, turn 3.
Yeah, it's like the safe play, and it's going to pay off. Okay, so play that. You play the Fairy Dragon.
Yeah, it's a very hard mini for the Rogue to deal with. Probably going to have to trade his own Edwin in.
Yeah. I see another way.
Do you ever go face if you're the Rogue here?
Should the Rogue.
Does damage really matter too much?
Yeah, you probably go face because if like the priest doesn't trade and just play like let's say Twilight Guardian, then you can just sap it and dagger up on the
Dragon. That's a very good point.
You can just punish him if he doesn't trade.
And I wonder if he plays around it. He's smart, very smart, of course. All right, so
he's playing Dragonfire Potion, which is really good in this matchup.
There is a that's actually huge in this matchup.
At some point, Hiccup could want to like play just Gadget and Coin and Conceal and think it's a safe play, and then Dragonfire Potion comes on.
And it's one of those things that you don't play around because you just expect every Dragon Priest to be cutting the card out nowadays. So.
Unless he saw that in previous turns.
Yeah. So. It's definitely something where, assuming Ecop's done his homework and he's looked at the VODs of Torque's previous matches, he may have seen that Dragonfire
Potion. Shadow Modest might be really good
that's
in this
huge.
Matchup.
That's huge. Yeah, that's one of the better Swashbuckler cards to get at this point. I don't mind the fan here, just to kind of, you know, cycle it. Hand doesn't look too great right now. He's got the Drake follow-up next turn. And then he's got the Gadget with the coins starting to develop as well.
Yeah, so basically this turn was kind of weak, but...
And we expect Torque to kind of keep the pressure going, maybe dropping the Drake here.
But he's going... Oh, look at Shadow Madness. It's going to be insane on this turn.
Oh, it's going to be huge.
It's going to be so insane because you just triggered the Twilight Guardian.
Yeah,
trade it into
you just clean the board up, and it's something you just can't play around. And it's going to be upsetting for Torque here. Oh, yeah, his eyes open wide, and he's...
Yeah, look at Thor's
face.
Definitely
something you can't play around or expect. And kind of Ecop's done what he needed to do. He's kind of bridged into turn 5 or 6 with 30 HP, which is certainly a total that he wants to be at this point. And he's got the gadgets, he's got the Drakes, so he's not going to run out of gas anytime soon. And it looks like he's already hovering over the gadget, going for the gadget.
Yeah.
Counterfeit coin conceal play, maybe.
The good point is that Thor can answer that, but the bad point is he's gonna lose his run with the Dragonfire Potion.
Yeah, if he goes that route, do you ever Dragonfire Potion just a gadget?
Yeah, of course you do.
You have to, I think.
Yeah, you have
so
to. It's like the best rogue card.
Yeah. Just it means giving up your entire board as well and just not developing at all, but at the same time, do you want the rogue to be able to cycle through their entire deck next
probably
turn?
Not.
Probably not.
So he's probably going to backstab the 2-6 to play around that. Yep.
Yeah, very smart choice there by Ecop. And unfortunate for Torque is that, you know, even if he goes with the Dragonfire Potion this turn, there's still so much gas on Ecop's side with the second gadget, with the Drake.
Ecop is just like going to play a Drake and empty board.
Yeah, and that's one of those cards that really is hard for the priest to deal with, you know, the 4-4 Drake just being such a pressuring minion.
Maybe you can just play like Argus.
Yeah, it just feels so bad to throw your Bronzebeard away like
I think it's a losing play, right?
Yeah.
You have to like expect Ecop to have like a full minion's hand and go with because Argus is really big with a Bronze on board.
Yeah. I mean, at the end of the day, how scary is 2-4, he's going to have a huge board here. So this is actually huge.
Yeah.
And it's for a class that has no AoE, I mean, he's got to put Ecop up on having a sap, which he probably has at least a sap at this point in the game.
It's always risky to leave catches on board, but I think it was a good play here.
Yeah, agreed.
Yeah, the sap is going to be...
I mean, let's see if he can draw into, like... He's going to need a way to deal with both of these huge minions. So he's got a 4-6 and a 4-8. You know, sap deals with one of them, but he's got to draw an answer
to
the second.
Do you ever play questing first? Okay. So he's looking for, like, if he gets like a backstab from the sap.
Huge.
Yeah, that would be so huge.
He can go backstab of this on the 4-6 Bronzebeard.
So yeah, backstab or preparation at the best draw, yeah. And it's none of those.
Yeah, it's a dead draw there for sure.
He can always pick a preparation now.
He can always trade the gadget in himself.
Yeah, of course.
That's always the worst option you don't want to do, but yeah.
Yeah, he's supposed to do.
I mean, he's got a 4-4 questing on board.
Dark's decision to kill the gadget action is going to pay off.
Yeah, definitely paid off there for Torque there. See if he can kind of claw his way back into this game.
Okay, but now there's another problem. You cannot kill this questing adventure.
Yeah, there's actually no answer. Wow. And look at the hand of Ekop. Like, he's got a lot of low-costing minions in hand to kind of make this questing get huge next turn. And there's not even a Shadow Word Death next turn in the Torque side.
So what do you do? Just play as much minion as you can?
Yeah, is this the point in the game where you kind of just flood the board and go face? You know, you've seen one sap be utilized. You have a lot of taunts in hand, so he's got both Wormist Agents. He's got one Twilight Guardian. Maybe this is the point in the game where the priest decides to maybe start racing the rogue. And it's kind of a hard concept to race a rogue, but really there's not many other options, you know, for Torque here.
If he goes for Dragonfire Potion, I think he can.
You just lose all tempo, yeah. And that's one of the problems with the card. It costs so much mana. So
he's probably going for that.
Yeah, it looks like he's going. Ooh,
oh, no.
He's not. Okay.
Okay.
I like this play. This is definitely what I would do myself.
That's the first play we were thinking about, and I think that's the best one.
And that's one of the problems with Dragonfire Potion in general. It's just 6 mana, man. It takes up the majority of your turn, so you're kind of, you know, you have this huge AoE, but...
So what? Oh, but if you play, like, second questing... And Tom Pillager, and you just conceal them. It depends if he is taking the trade. But if he trades in like any minion and goes for that, then he's gonna get punished so hard.
This Dragonfire might be extremely, extremely punishing by Torque, and his patience with it may end up paying off. But yeah, if he ends up trading this like 6-6 questing into the 3-6 taunt, that Dragonfire might be enough to clear off both questings next turn. And Ekop's kind of like, you know, Ekop kind of looks, he's playing this kind of like he knows there's a Dragonfire in the deck. Because usually a rogue would kind of be fine just going all in.
You can play around that. You can play around that by not trading,
yeah.
Just sitting down and hold.
Wow.
Okay, so... Yeah, Torque is still losing all his board, but yeah, now you have to do that.
Yeah,
it's
huge.
Not like, yeah, maybe I can do something else. No. No, that's the time you use it.
And look at this. He's already gotten Ekop down to 12 HP, so we're approaching the point in the game where the rogue is definitely under a lot of pressure, and this Dragonfire, Ekop knows, and he's a little upset by it.
Yeah, but he has a lot of follow-up, like Double Drake and...
Yeah, there's definitely a lot of gas left in Ekop's hand. The question is, you know, can the priest, you know, just kind of go face and pressure down that 12 remaining health total?
I don't know. As we said before, it's always hard to finish your opponent as a priest because you have, like, no damage from hand.
So many options.
Maybe you can hope for, like, a Draconid Operative, which gives you, like, Eviscerate or stuff.
Yeah. That'd be huge. I mean, Bronzebeard has already been utilized.
Oh my god, look at that. You can go for coin second Drake, and then backstab for 4. He's not going for that.
I don't like this, because then you're taking 3 here.
Yeah, and you don't want to. Okay.
Does he still have patches in his deck? Have we seen patches from the rogue?
Yeah, I would
early
say.
Early on?
Yeah. I would say we have seen it.
With Swashburglar.
Like on turn 2 or 3.
Yeah, with Swashburglar, yeah. But wow, taking that 3 damage, so...
Yeah.
I mean, Blackwing Corruptors are still in his hand.
Oh, and the Draconid we were talking about.
Yeah.
So if you get, like, some damage from that.
Do you ever...
Or even a conceal. Oh, but he saw both conceals. Yeah. Conceal would have been huge, but we saw both.
And,
Now you're giving value to, like, Bookworm and Shadow Pain. And that wouldn't have been the case if he played a Double Drake.
Yeah, and Torque goes with a safe line. He still feels like he can kind of control this board. Little does he know that Ekop does have so much cycle still left in his hand.
Oh, second gadget action, yeah.
Second gadget, second Drake. I don't mind the sap even
yeah.
here.
Yeah. You have like no other target for that bookworm, so. Okay, he's going for cold blood. So giving Shadow of Death some value, but I mean you have to raise the priest at some point.
Oof. That's a lot of damage over two turns coming up here. And I don't see, you know, I don't see a way that Tor can do 9 damage next turn.
Yeah. And yeah, he cannot live for 2 turns, right?
Yeah, I don't see a way.
Oh, he's using Eviscerate.
Wow, using the Eviscerate instead of the sap.
I don't know about that.
Yeah, what else do you sap in this matchup at this point in the game? And I mean, look at Edikov's hand. You know, if there's a Shadow or Death top deck here, is Fatigue ever a possibility for the Dragon Priest against the Rogue? I mean, there's only a few cards left.
Or even the 1-mana potion. Oh, is it called? Like the 1-mana potion, you take Talnas, trade it into the
Yeah,
trade.
That's true.
But yeah, he didn't get that. Oh, this is bad.
Yeah, it doesn't look too good. I mean, I think
you Swashburg
go for what? Eviscerate, maybe?
Yeah, probably.
Sap, even.
Yeah, okay.
Shadow Strike. Yeah, there's a few good options. You have to go Swashburglar here, in my opinion.
Swashburglar into what? And it is...
Ooh!
It could have been this thing, but yes.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, only 4 mana, so... Cannot play on this turn.
I mean, if Ecop doesn't draw lethal here, like, he's at the point where he's got to trade as well. Like, he can't just ignore the priest's board. But, I mean, being patient with his sap here is going to pay off. I mean, he has the Draconoid Operative to sap here. But he's going to first prep. He's going to try to somehow draw into lethal. He's got, let's see, 12, 13 on board.
What does he have left?
He's got Leroy, so...
Oh, and the Cold Blood. So, yeah, it's like 100% lethal. How many cards does he have? Maybe you can see that. Oh,
yeah,
cards. So
it's actually 100% lethal.
He's going to get to draw Leroy at some point. And being able to kill the priest...
He should know it, too.
Series.
Yeah, he's got one card left in his deck, so he should know that the sap is going to draw into his final... Maybe he's not playing Leroy. I can't imagine that, though.
Yeah, I can. He's not playing
He's not playing Leroy. Wow.
Okay.
Can he ever get fatigued out in this case?
Yeah, he might.
Because now you can't even play the sap.
You have Talnas on board.
By playing the sap, you take 1 fatigue damage, then you take 2 fatigue damage next turn...
He messed up by playing the preparation.
The problem is there's no activator for the Blackwing Corruptor now in his hand of Torque.
Well, he's going for Piltress. Oh god.
Piltress into Leroy.
But you Torque wins. You just have to like if he picks up a dragon, you can Oh, but he has a dragon. So you just go Blackwing Face and then
trade both minions in. 3.
You just killed Talnas.
Wait. He's taking 2 fatigue damage next turn, right? 2 plus 3 plus 2.
So you just killed Talnas and it's it? That's it? He's taking 2 plus 3 plus the Blackwing Corruptor?
Wait, move your mouse.
Oh, sorry.
So he's taking... Do you even have to kill... Wait, if he just... He's taking 2 plus 2 plus... Oh, yeah. So
you can use Assassinate on Talnas.
Oh, my God. This
assassinate
is lethal.
Talnas.
Don't miss
just
it, Torque.
Just go face.
Torque, don't miss it.
Don't
so
miss.
Assassinate on the Blood Mage. Wow.
You don't even have to do that. He's taking 2. You just pass
he's
and
just he's
dead.
Two, right? He's just taking 2, right?
Yeah,
that's what I thought
just
initially.
Pass and he's dead.
Wow.
He messed up.
I think Ecop
Look
messed
at
up
Ecop's
there.
Face.
And Ecop is, he's bewildered himself.
And he used the preparation and he's left with
Wow. Magic. I am,
I'm so surprised he lost that.
Wow. He had everything. There's no way that the priest can ever deal with that board. Just kill off your own gadget. Don't draw into fatigue.
Do you think he was expecting to play Leroy or what?
Did he almost forget that he was... the way he was playing it, I assumed he had Leroy. Both assumed that he must have Leroy as his last card.
That's why he used preparation, right?
Yeah. Why else would he purposely draw into fatigue? But no, there's no Leroy in the deck. And,
so Ica Blowzone and Torque is playing the series.
And that was... that's as we expected. They have a mirror lineups on both sides. Both players playing the same decks. And winning that first game was huge for Ecop, but Torque able to win a couple
And
matchups.
I think overall Torque played so well.
Yeah, he played great. I think his patience with the Dragonfire potion
last
game.
Yeah, the Dragonfire potion.
We both didn't expect him to be that patient with it and end up paying dividends. And winning that matchup in Fatigue, not something you always see for the Dragon Priest against the Rogue. And Torque being the first winner in Group B.
He's going to face the winner of Jackie Chan against Stan Sivka.
Against Stan Sivka, which is going to be coming up shortly for you guys. And stay tuned, guys. We're going to be taking a short break now, but we will be back with more action here at Seat Story Cup.